Okay, we're here with Eric again. Topic today is kind of a strong topic that's been going around the internet a lot. 2300 question mark days question mark. Let's get into this one, Eric.
There's a great book written called 2300 Days of Hell by Joseph Dumont. I recommend the book, it's exceptional, but the topic study, where does he come up with this title, 2300 Days of Hell? Comes out of Daniel chapter 8, verse 14. There's another fellow, Tom Stapleton, I have a good regard to him as well, up in Kelowna, BC, Canada. He's in the midst of writing a book interfacing Daniel with the book of Revelation. The man's got some good insight, some good scholarly study. And it's about these same matters. It's the fourth beast. There's some discussion in Daniel chapter 7, Daniel chapter 8, Daniel chapter 9. The Erechtology study that prompted the class is Daniel chapter 12, which is the last chapter of the book of Daniel, just so you know. But this matter of what's going to happen in the last days, that's called eschatology. And it's been the matter of many books, thousands of sermons, quite a lot of discussion. People have speculated for centuries, what is the circumstances at the time of the end? So if you read it in English, you could translate it 2300 Days of Hell. What we're going to do here is make a few different videos, just so you know. This one is going to be kept kind of short, and I'm just going to address the matter of how do you get what out of the words, which gives you a translation, which is why there's so much discussion.
I think that's a good topic, Eric, because people get locked into a book or a doctrine like the SDAs and the 2300 days, and others dispute it, and they'll say, no, it's evening and morning sacrifices. And people just pick an opinion, and it happens to be the opinion of others, but let's look at these words and see what they say to keep all our bases covered and our perception open rather than locked into one pattern that has to go by these steps here. This is the way it's going to go down. Not necessarily so. And I think that's the topic, right?
Well, a couple other videos after this, which hopefully we'll get to today. This is Pesach of 2017, or Chag HaMatzot of 2017. We'll address those other, what's written in Daniel's chapter 7, chapter 8, chapter 9, in a couple other videos. What I'm going to address right now is, how do these words actually read? That's translated 2300 Days of Hell, and what is the precursor? What are the words right before this, in the few verses before verse 14, that sets up what this is talking about? I'm going to read, just real quick, you guys haven't heard this, but I'm going to read four verses. I'll read verses 11 through 14 of Daniel 8. And this is a translation which I rendered a few days ago. What determines inflation? The size, the extent, the growth. What finances the development? We being away from him, the noteworthy designated appointment, which has been for all time continuously, directly, immediately, at the hand of rejecting Kadosh as was directed. Now that maybe sounds kind of awkward or cryptic, and what I'm trying to do here is look at the exact Hebrew word and give it a meaning, which most translations try to take one word for one word, English substituted for Hebrew, coming out of the Septuagint of Greek, and even if they go back to the Hebrew or even Aramaic, it's like Hebrew works like beads on a chain. There's this word, there's this word, there's this word. What do you do with them? And we don't know necessarily which one is the subject, the object, the predicate, the verb, the noun, the adjective. And so the reason why you get different translations is because the English translators are of different opinion. Is this past tense? Is this future tense? In English, as I've said on other videos, we say White House. So the adjective is before the noun. But in Spanish, it's casa blanca. The noun is before the adjective. Spanish is real close to Hebrew, and Hebrew does the same thing. But is that necessarily accurate? You'll have different linguistic scholars disagree, even. So here, if you just look at the words, they're like beads on a chain, separated from each other, and English throws in all these filler words to make it make sense, and then reshuffles the words, and so if you look at an interlinear, you'll see that sometimes the English summary, the sentence as it reads, that we call a verse, actually is reshuffled the beginning of the verse with the later part of the verse, and even unplugged this word and stuck in and over here and this one over there to make it read in the context. And you say, well, are they accurate? Well, if you're, you know, ordained by the Holy Spirit and under His guidance, you'd say, sure, you bet. But then you look at the language, it's like, well, how in the world did they come up with that? Well, it was the Holy Spirit. But why is there then different translations? And why is a Jewish translation completely different? And one of the first things that I bumped into is saying, well, if the King James Version, the KJV, is guided by the Holy Spirit, why does it disagree from a Jewish translation? Don't the Jews know their own language? And yet some verses were virtually indistinguishable. You can't even notice they're talking about the same verse. And sometimes the meaning is, you can see it's kind of the same verse, but it's opposite. Why would it be opposite? That got me going on this whole methodology of study. What I'm seeing here is what finances the development. Where do you get that? You're not going to read that in English, because the word there means finances, and this other word means that which inflates or develops, which is to say the first phrase, what determines the inflation, the size, the extent, the growth. That's three, four different ways to read the same two words. And I'm trying to embellish what the words are saying by inflating so that we can wrap our minds around it and give maybe a sentence to a word or a couple sentences to just two or three words. That's what's going on here. So when this says it's postulating, what? We're bewildered. What determines how big and how long this thing rolls through history? The answer is the very next couple of words that says, we, well, who's we? It's all about Israel and the covenant with Yahweh. We, His people, pulling ourselves away from what He said to do. That's us rejecting the Kadosh as directed. He said, do this, and we go, no way, and we pull away. Okay, as long as you guys pull away and go somewhere else, that determines the extent, and the longer it goes, the bigger it gets, so it determines the size, and that's what finances. So if you have a creditor, say, financing a project, or a producer financing the making of a movie, we are making this movie, this drama of the tragedy of world history, by us choosing to be away, and the longer we're away from what He said to do, the bigger and longer this thing gets. That's what this is saying. Verse 12, inflation of war is permitted and even appointed accordingly to the continuity of criminal trespass. That's us breaking His Torah. The discard, the rejection of truth, which then itself, us doing that, narrates and produces the fitness to succeed, for mayhem to prosper. In other words, we see the war machine inflating. It's like, gosh, who's driving this? Well, it's those bad guys. It's those conspiracy, you know, the people under, it's the new world. No, it's us. We being away from His instructions feeds them, feeds the monster. As opposed to breakthrough, there's a word there that literally means breakthrough, which is a picture of a dish which gets broken. We can break the system simply by going back and doing what He said, which is otherwise known as the kadosh, the prescribed. This word kadosh may be saying strange to some people. It's the word uttered from the mouth of the creatures around the throne with the four faces. Around Yahweh's throne, they say, they're not saying holy, holy, holy. That's a translated word. It says they're saying kadosh, kadosh, kadosh. So then you have to know, well, what does that mean? Well, it's translated holy. It's much more than that. It's pure, undefiled, doesn't have any man's fingerprints on it. It's his stuff, which is completely separated, aloof, beyond otherworldly. And we're called to be kadosh yelionin, which is, that's in chapter 7, which is to say people of the Most High, betrothed unto him. But it's also, we choose to be, as it says in Leviticus 19:2, I am kadosh, therefore you will be kadosh. So that's why we eat certain things, wear certain things, don't work on certain days, because he said to. That's being kadosh, being removed from the typical world, common, regular way of doing things, because he said so. That's what it means to be kadosh. So this breakthrough breaks the container, breaks the barrier, and opens up the possibilities of what he said was going to happen. Verse 13. I heard one kadosh communication. And the declaration is one kadosh communication. Same viscosity, that's the meaning of that word there. One. When he says Shema Israel, Yahweh Elohenu, Yahweh Echad, there's a unity. When Yeshua said, hey, I and my Father are one, he didn't claim to be the Father. He said, we are indistinguishable because we have the same voice, same message, same communication, same behavior. If you see me, you've seen him. He's this invisible guy that you can't hear his voice, but I'm speaking his words, just what he said, I say, what I see him do, I do. So there's this concept. You have to understand the word Echad, and it doesn't mean, oh yeah, me and him are the same guy. That's the way it's been interpreted. That's a whole other matter. Going on in verse 13. Until when? How long, my corpse? How long do I have to live like a dead man? How long do I have to live like I'm the... What's that term they use for people coming up for walking half dead? A zombie apocalypse. Jeez. Israel is a picture of the zombie apocalypse. We're walking along half dead, unable to do stuff that real people do, according to the promise that he gave us. We are the zombies. Can't put it on somebody else. And then it goes on to say, the pacemaker, or that which prolongs the extension, is connected to the criminal transgression. This is just another reiteration of what he said a moment ago. Insane waste, appalling desolation, astounding horror, subterfuge, undermining the status of kadosh, hallowedness, so that the prohibition of don't mess with her or else, which is what Yahweh said about Israel, said to the world, you touch her and you got me, don't mess with her. That is rendered void. We're out on our own, without protection, without a covering, thus attracting war and mustering, inviting a time of trampling. That's been happening for these 2,000, 3,000 years. That's what this verse says, Daniel 8:13. Now verse 14. He, remember this is one kadosh communication, this is a singular voice. He declared to me the evidence of when, which is to say, what is the indicator of recognizing when the time is at hand? What are the circumstances that would let us know, hey, time's up, we can change this whole thing, we can break this bowl that we've been put in and get back his covering, his protection and his favor that he keeps promising all through the scripture. Having compromised jurisdiction, having blended allegiance, this is what we did in the past and still continuously, which is to say multiples authorities with legally vested interest. Now, where the sole responsibility would have been, we are Yahweh's responsibility, we sold stock of our provision, benefit, interest, as it were, to other people, other powers, so that the heart of Israel, we gave somebody else stock in us. And so Yahweh said, that's it, I'm out of here. He's not going to share his people with somebody else. So it's kind of like this. If I have a guitar worth $1,000 and I go to and I need some bucks and I just don't have them, so I'm going to go down to the pawn shop and I say, listen, I own this. Will you give me some money? And he says, sure, I'll give you $100 to hold it. Now he's vested interest. He owns part of this guitar. I can't just take the guitar. He holds the guitar. I can spend $100. I got to pay him back with interest. But if I want that guitar back, I got to give him back the whole thing. Now it's all mine. But until it's all mine, I've now sold out to him. That's what this is saying. Yahweh said, you are mine. And his people, by doing other things, turning away from him and becoming liege to or under the allegiance of other powers, whether they world powers or traditions or other gods, other idols, we basically sold out part of our heart, part of the interest in our well-being to somebody else, some other authority. So we have a blended allegiance, we have a blended responsibility over us, meaning that we feel that somebody else is going to take care of us other than him, and somebody else has a voice. If Yahweh says, like he said to the Israelites in Egypt, come out here and worship me in the wilderness. Okay, let's go. No, we can't. Pharaoh says we can't go. Oh, I can't take the day off to acknowledge Shabbat because my boss won't let me. Oh, he's calling up and saying, you get over here right now and sorry. When we sell out to somebody else's authority, we can't do what Yahweh says to do when he says to do it, as if he's the only guy that says, right now. And we go, can I ask permission first? He said, okay. That's what this means. It's quite a dilemma. Now the next word means separate, cleave, split, distinguish, investigate, examine the matter, turn toward my mouth. Taught, trained, domesticated, yoked, teamed up with the house. So what he's saying is, when you stop your allegiance to this blended authority, separate, cleave, split, distinguish, by investigating the words I told you, so, well, something's going to happen. Mediate the negotiation. As a referee, arbitrate. Wait a minute, is it this or it's this? Stand in the middle here and determine. It's the picture of a retailer. A retailer takes the things grown by the farmer, and then he has a counter, and the purchaser, the one who wants to buy it, doesn't go to the farmer, he goes to the retailer. So this guy comes, and the retailer marks it up a bit, but he takes from the grower and he gives to the buyer. That's this word, shalish, which is sheen lamed sheen. It's the number 3, and that's what that means. The next word, this is verse 14 of chapter 8. At the place agreed, according to the letter, as notarized, exactly as it has been longed for and desired from the beginning until the end. Even so, kadosh blossoms instantly, automatically. Rectify, justify, set free, deliverance, annulling the claims from the blended authority of the vested interest. Now, I just threw a bunch of words out there and you're going, wait a minute, I'm lost. What's going on? Maybe you didn't recognize it, but I just said 2,300 days of hell. What? Where'd that come in? I just read a definition of the 2,300 days of hell. And what I'm saying by bringing in verses 11, 12, and 13, I'm saying, what's the context of this verse? It's setting up, how long do we have to get beaten up? How long do we have to put up with the trouble, the confusion, the problem, this authority over us? And what he said was, I will now read it again. What he said literally, this is verse 14. He declared to me, until blending, that's the mixed allegiance and mixed responsibility. Breaking open, that's the word boker. The first word was a rev, mixed blending. The next word is boker, cleave, distinguish, separate, examine. Which is to say, don't just yell at me what's going on, look what's going on and why. Well, he just told us the 3 verses ahead of time why it's going on. We sold out allegiance. We took his promises, took them to the pawn shop and asked the government and asked other deities and asked somebody else to get involved because his word, his promises just wasn't good enough. Israel looked at Assyria and Egypt and go, wow, they got some cool customs. They got some nice fancy clothes. In fact, I really like the way, and that's literally what the story tells us. Israel did. They looked to Assyria and Egypt and liked the way they looked and dressed up in their attire instead of dressing up in what Yahweh said, which was his Moedim, his festivals. There's a verse where he says, Yahweh made a nice outfit for himself and says, I think this is pretty snazzy. And he says, here, to his wife, I want you to dress up in this too. I think you look pretty nice in that. And Israel goes, ew, this thing? I'd rather dress up like the Assyrians and Egyptians. Which is what's happened, clear till now. This is what this is talking about. The next word is alephim. Well, the word aleph is 1,000. Alephim meaning 2,000. But the word aleph means taught, trained, domesticated, yoked, and teamed up with the house. Well, does it mean 2,000? Or does it mean that we should distinguish and separate to become yoked to his house instead of being yoked and teamed up with the pawn shop, the creditor that we sold our rights to, our autonomy to. The next word is shalish. That's translated three, but it literally means mediate the negotiation. Intercede. That's the word. You want to be an intercessor? That's the word shalish. The next word is ma'ot, which is translated 100. This is where you get 2,300. Alephim, veshalish, ma'ot. The word ot means oath, as agreed. The letter mem as a prefix means the place or being away from the place. It also means that mem is used as a device which turns a vague concept into a noun, an abstract noun. Like knowing something, that's this vague concept, but knowledge, this isn't knowledge, it's not an object, so it's an abstract noun. So the mem turns this concept into an object, an abstract noun. So me'ot is the oath, but oath is also a sign, a symbol, some type of a signal. It's the stipulation and the agreement, so it's this object, it represents something. There's this little symbol on my hat here that's an aleph and a tav, or the aleph-tav. That thing which he set forth is accomplished. The word going out of his mouth will happen, just like he said. So it's this thing taking substance. It's also a letter of the alphabet. Oath, aleph, bav, tav is a letter of the alphabet. There's a place in Jeremiah 31:31 where Yahweh says, they will all know me, from the least of these to the greatest. That word me is aleph, bav, tav, yod. It could be read as my oath, my signal, sign, symbol, my symbol. Aleph, tav is a symbol that says everything he said he will certainly do. They will all know me is actually they will all know my symbol, my insignia, my fingerprint, that when I say something, it happens. That's what it means to know me. So this is that same word, me'ot. They will all know my oath. By every letter I said will happen just like I said it. Well, how do you know that? You can only know that if you come back to his house to be taught, trained, domesticated, yoked, and teamed up with him according to every word he said. And then the next word says, and blossoming or rectifying or making zadik, making righteousness sprout, kadosh is the last word, which means just like it was out of his mouth. You see 2,300 days of hell? There's another place where it talks about this, but what I'm saying is, you have to go back and plug this in and say, where's hell? There's another place where it talks about Shemam, which is astounding desolation. So now we have to plug that in. This is where the 2,300 days comes from. It doesn't say days. What it says is, Arev, Boker, blended, separated. Blended what? I'm saying, if you look back at the first three verses, it says, it's talking about how long does this horrible situation remain until you guys, until us guys, until I come back to him as he said. And because my being away from him inflates, extends, finances, feeds the monster, there's this old saying, you know, this guy had a dream, white dog and a black dog fighting, and it's like, well, which one is going to win? The one you feed the most. Okay. How long does the monster get bigger and remain and tear things apart? As long as we feed the monster. How do we stop feeding the monster? Do what he said. Return to the Kadosh. Okay, so if we're going to say, well, now let's interpret the rest of this vision that Daniel had about the duration and the effect of this fourth beast that he saw, Daniel chapter 8.
That'll be another video.
It'll be another video, but what I'm saying is, if we're going to translate what is this beast doing, how are we reading the words? This business of going back and looking at these words changes the translation, changes the meaning, and instead of talking about, gee, this monster, no, it's talking about us being the monster. So we change our behavior, and guess what? The monster's behavior has changed. But we don't read it that way, so books have been written and are being written, and sermons and eschatological paradigms for centuries.
Yeah, that's never made sense. All this doom and destruction, when you look back in the covenant promises, all the blessings as opposed to the curses. Why the curses if we're returning to Him? It's just like we're waiting for Him to show up. Oh, He should be here any time. The time's about up. He's got to get here pretty soon. Why don't we just sit around and do nothing? That seems like it's paradoxical to what He's actually promised us.
Every word can be read differently than the way it reads in that English translation text. Every Hebrew word can be read differently. That's what I've found. Now, I have a choice. Do I think I'm so smart that I can trust me instead of all these other translators? No, not a bit. I better not trust me. Well, then why am I trusting my translation? Because here's my choice. I can believe the translations that don't seem to be aleph-theme, they don't seem to be taught, trained, and domesticated of His house. As a matter of fact, they said all the words of His house had a nail stuck into them and stuck to the cross and buried and done away with. Whereas I read these words and say, no, these are forever. As a matter of fact, the curse is if you think they've been done away with, so you behave as if they've been done away with, you continue the curse. But if you come back to these words and do what they say, then guess what? Everything's going to change. So whose interest is it to make me think these words are done away with? The beast? Well, how do you kill the beast? Go back to the very words He gave us that the beast was trying to tell me was done away with. Okay, so if I trust the translators who have no interest because they own the publishing houses, because they own the news media, because they are the beast that gets fed by me who's staying away, if I trust their translations, the beast gets bigger for longer. But if I take the effort to go back and look at these words and figure out who said them and what was the promise that they don't want me to hear, remember the last words out of Moshe's mouth. In Deuteronomy 34, he says, Israel, there's nobody like you with such a promise and such faith. Your enemies will try to deceive you. Remember that. See ya. And Moshe's out. The last words, your enemies will try to deceive you. The only way to not be deceived is to go back and look at these words in Hebrew for yourself, and then if you don't want to be fooled by your own inabilities, you better be diligent to figure out what these words mean. And that's what this is all about. That's all what growing in grace and Torah is all about.
Well, I appreciate that. It gives us something else to think about, apart from relying on somebody else's understanding to get back and see that the word day isn't there. It's controversial whether it's even 2300. There's just a lot. We got to keep these things laid out on the table and not getting set in one mindset, because it could go different directions than we had planned, and then we're all confused. Then we'll go back to the words. So we might as well do that now.
We might be complaining about where the bus is going only to find out that we're the driver of the bus.
Oh, that's so true.
You want to start another one now? I'm going to start uploading this one and then
is get that to over?
Well, we're about 30 minutes. You got some 20
you still
minutes.
On?
Yeah.
Go ahead and turn it off. We'll do it now.
All right.
Yeah, that's a good place to